the truth behind 5G. As 5G technology begins to get implemented all around the world, there is a lot of confusion and concern over what it is, how it works, and if it is even safe. So today we are going to go over all the aspects of 5G. 5G technology, or the fifth generation of these data networks, has been getting a lot of hype and it's been talked about a lot. It has been slowly being rolled out over the past year or two and getting insane speeds on some phones. So the wavelengths used for 5G technologies can be split into three different sections. There is low band 5G, which is frequencies below about 1 GHz. Then there is what we called mid band 5G, which is slightly above that, which is faster but travels a shorter distance. And then there is a millimeter wave, which is talked about the most, which can give you the fastest speeds and uses the highest frequencies but travels the shortest distance. And so with 5G, now we are talking about download speeds of anywhere from 50 megabytes per second all the way up to those crazy millimeter wave speeds you might have seen of like 2 gigabytes per second. Which means that we are talking like a whole TV show season downloaded in seconds. So having these high-end speeds and low latency in the future will be essential for things like fleets of driverless cars, all driving as a swarm and all talking, communicating with each other to never crash. All the way to things like a robot and a surgeon in two different states, but that surgery being performed remotely in real time. So it would take a lot of nodes and a lot of antennas just to cover a small area like a town, let alone a country or the entire globe, and that would be expensive and time consuming. But even the low to mid band 5G can still be impressive in terms of improvement in speed. So there is a lot going on, but it is a pretty exciting future of 5G. But with that comes a lot of fears and concerns about the potential effects of these new frequencies on our biology and on our health. So how does 5G actually work? In order to fully understand 5G, we actually have to learn about electromagnetic spectrum. And this is a spectrum of radiation. So it does sound scary, but it's important that we know that radiation is just the transmission of energy through waves or particles. On the left of the spectrum, we have really long wavelengths, some as long as thousands of kilometers. And as we move to the right, they get shorter and shorter to even a fraction of the size of an atom nucleus. Now, a wavelength size is measured from peak to peak or trough to trough. As the wavelengths become shorter and shorter, they have higher frequencies and energy. Frequency describes the number of waves that passes a fixed place in a given amount of time and is usually measured in hertz each set. So a low frequency will fit less wavelengths and a high frequency more. Take gamma rays for example, which can be 10 to the power of minus 12 meters, which is 0.00000000001 meters. And they are generated by radioactive atoms and nuclear explosions. And these gamma rays, along with X-rays and higher energy UV radiation, can damage DNA and destroy cells, also known as being ionizing. And that is scary. As we move back to the left, the wavelengths get longer and have less and less energy and are no longer ionizing. This part of the spectrum is the wavelength size that the cells in your eyes evolved to see, otherwise known as visible light. Every single wavelength your eyes pick up fall within 400 to 700 nanometers. If we keep moving left, we go through microwaves and radio waves, which are also called radio frequency radiation. This low energy, low frequency radiation has been used in technology like radios since the late 1800s. But it wasn't until the 1980s that the first generation of cellular technology, or 1G, began. 1G cellular attack in the 1980s used 150 MHz aka UHF ultra high frequency waves. 2G was using around 450 MHz, more ultra high frequency waves. 3G was allocated frequencies between 450 MHz all the way up to 3 GHz. This was in the spectrum known as super high frequencies. 4G was allocated similar frequencies to 3G but was taking advantage of some of those higher frequencies, which takes us now to 5G, which is allocated between 600 MHz to as high as between 38 to 90 GHz. So it is also using a super high frequency section, but for the first time in cellular network technology. Thankfully, the electromagnetic spectrum is regulated to keep us all healthy. An important regulating body and all of this is an International Commission of Non-Ionizing Radiation Protection, which is essentially a conglomeration of epidemiologists, biologists and physicists and people who understand this technology very deeply, who take all the most up-to-date science and make sure they understand and regulate what this radiation is doing to all of us. It is also important to note that this regulating body isn't connected to any one government or a country or commercial corporation. Which leads us to the big question, how do 5G waves affect us? We know that 5G frequencies are not ionizing radiation. But should we be worried about them impacting our body in other ways? After decades of research on health effects, the ICNIRP found the only substantiated effect of radio frequency exposure is heating of exposed tissue. These wavelengths can cause vibration of charged or polar molecules inside of us, which creates friction and thus heat. But the higher the frequency, the lower the penetrative depth in the body, which might seem a little unnerving, and it's fair to have concern because technically there is a thermal threshold that if we pass can cause adverse health effects on us. But that's why all these regulating bodies are there, to make sure that our exposure never goes over that threshold. In fact, acute and long-term effects of radio frequency exposure below the thermal threshold has been studied extensively without demonstrating adverse health effects. Research has even been done on headaches, sleep quality, cognitive function, etc., and has shown no issues. One other thing that was found was a small effect on brain activity when measured by EEGs. But the biological implication of what that means is pretty small, and they haven't actually seen any negative effects associated to this brain activity. So why do some people say that 5G can cause cancer? There are a few studies that often get quoted. And one, lab rats and mice were exposed to radio frequency energy used in cell phones for 9 hours a day starting before birth and for 2 hours after, and found an increased risk of some types of tumors in the male rats. But the male rats exposed to radio frequency radiation actually ended up living longer than the other rats, and the female rats and all of mice in the experiment didn't have an increase in tumors at all. Some other epidemiological studies have found a small increase in some brain tumors in people who are heavy users of cell phones. But it was actually found that there were reporting biases and weaknesses in these studies. Also, it's important to remember that these studies are on cell phone use. So they're actually talking about 3G, 4G and 5G frequencies. The consensus among scientists is that 5G technology will not cause cancer. But it is very confusing to figure out this information when you are looking online. At the end of the day, what it comes down to is scientists looking at large trials with large sample sizes and controlling variables. One very large 13-country-wide study found that there was no causal relationship between brain tumors and cell phone use. And another really great Danish study, large study, also found that there was no link. So now let's talk about the conspiracies. First, we'll address the elephant in the room, the new online theory that 5G causes coronavirus. So this one is relatively easy to debunk. 5G technology cannot break chemical bonds, which is a common claim that conspiracy theorists use. On top of the fact that viruses are visible, we can literally see that they physically exist. We can study them. We can look at their literal DNA. So ultimately, just know that 5G does not cause coronavirus. Is 5G bad for birds? This study is quoted often to explain how the electromagnetic noise of 5G can disrupt the migration of birds. But these researchers actually found that it is longer wavelengths, more like similar to AM radio type wavelengths, that were actually affecting migrating birds. And they have actually come out and tried to speak openly, trying to explain that their research is getting cherry-picked to try and say something about 5G that they never said. So to recap, 1. 5G uses wavelengths within the super high and extra high frequency spectrum. 2. These fall into the category of non-ionizing radiation, meaning they can't damage DNA or destroy cells. 3. 5G does have the capacity to reduce heat-exposed tissue, but due to regulation will remain below the threshold known to cause any damage. 4. The current scientific consensus is that 5G does not show adverse impacts on health like headaches, sleep, cognitive function or cancer. And 5. 5G has nothing to do with coronavirus. Now, some conspiracy to theories might also be true, but at the end of the day, we also need to listen to science and to listen to the scientific consensus in order to guide our knowledge. At the same time, it's also important that we continue to regulate and understand how all of these technologies that are going to be used around us work. We hope you liked this video. Please comment and let us know what you think, and make sure to subscribe to our channel for more videos like these.